Welcome aboard, everyone, as the forces continue to gather. We have about a minute or so until we get to our start time, and I see people are still joining, so we'll give it a little bit longer. While we are waiting for everyone, I'll just remind everybody that that the meeting is being not only recorded, but also live streamed. So all of you are on video, make sure you're all, you know, in good shape here. and we will, yeah, there you go. So as I said, we'll give it just a little bit longer for folks to join, and then we will get started. All righty, now that the official clock has struck, we will go ahead and get started here this evening. Again, thank you for taking the time this Monday evening to join us to get further information about important matters that will be on the agenda for our Diocesan Convention. We really appreciate all of you who come out to get informed ahead of time because it does make our convention process run so much more smoothly. So thank you for taking the time to be here tonight. It is your opportunity not only to learn more from the presentations, but also to ask any questions that you might have. Now is a great time to do that, much more time to do that and much easier to do that than it is on the convention floor. So being as today is the day when we honor Absalom Jones, I would like to go ahead and start out with his collect and then a couple of prayers, one for the diocese and one for our meeting this evening. So let us pray. First, for Absalom Jones. Set us free, Heavenly Father, from every bond of prejudice and fear, that honoring the steadfast courage of your servant Absalom Jones, we may show forth in our lives the reconciling love and true freedom of the children of God, which you have given us in your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
And then our prayer for the diocese. O God, by your grace, you have called us in this diocese to a goodly fellowship of faith. Bless our bishop-elect, and our other clergy, and all our people. Grant that your word may be truly preached and truly heard, your sacraments faithfully administered and faithfully received. By your Spirit, fashion our lives according to the example of your Son, and grant that we may show the power of your love to all among whom we live. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And then finally for our meeting tonight. Almighty and ever-living God, source of all wisdom and understanding, be present with those who take counsel for the renewal and mission of your church. Teach us in all things to seek first your honor and glory. Guide us to perceive what is right and grant us both the courage to pursue it and the grace to accomplish it. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Well, again, welcome tonight. And then also a special welcome to our presenters this evening. We will have with us the Reverend Dr. Jeffrey Kirk, who will be presenting on Constitution and Canons, the Reverend Susanna Cates, who will be presenting on resolutions, and assisting her with the first of the resolutions, which has to do with our Episcopal Mental and Spiritual Health Ministry, is the very Reverend Dr. Caroline Carson, who will also be adding some wisdom and information to that presentation. And then finally, we'll have Jonathan Gloucester, our diocesan treasurer, to give us our presentation on the budget. So without further ado, I would like to go ahead and turn it over to Father Jeff Kirk to give us our presentation on Constitution and Canons. Father Kirk, would you like me to share my screen with the text of that, or do you prefer I not do that? And you are on mute. May also be having some trouble with this video. Can you hear me, Father Kirk?
Pardon me. Excuse me, I'm sorry. Could you give me that subject again, please?
He's going to be presenting on Constitution and Canons.
Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. But I think as it looks like he may still be getting himself sorted out there. So perhaps we will go up there. He just saw him for a minute. Yeah, I think I'm going to go ahead and just go a little bit out of order, give that a little time to sort itself out, and perhaps ask the Reverend Susanna Cates to get us started with resolutions in tandem with the very Reverend Caroline Carson. So, Susanna, are you there?
I am.
Wonderful. Would you like me to share my screen?
That would be great if you have the report of our preliminary report of our committee pulled up myself, but if everyone else would like to see them, that would be great.
Sure. And while we're doing this, sharing it on the screen, let me also just add that all of these documents are available on the diocesan website under the Diocesan Convention heading. And answering, there was a question that I saw Henry posted in the chat about where these videos are available. I believe they are also available in the convention section of the website, the recordings of all of the pre-convention hearings, not even just this one. So without further ado then, Susanna, take it away.
Thank you very much. We received three proposed resolutions by the January 15th deadline, and they are reported below. We have not had our final meeting for the Committee on Resolutions, but that is happening this Saturday, which is February the 18th. And the Zoom information for that meeting is actually in the preliminary report, because of course that's an open meeting, particularly for those people who feel the need to defend the resolutions that they have submitted to the committee. Resolution 2023-1. The subject is to establish a pastoral mental and spiritual health committee in the Diocese of New Jersey. I'll read the resolution statement and the further resolution statement, and then I will ask the Reverend Caroline Carson if she would like to say a word or two about that. Be it resolved that the 239th Convention of the Diocese of New Jersey affirm the importance of good mental and spiritual health for all members of the diocese. And be it further resolved that the Diocese of New Jersey establish a pastoral mental and spiritual health committee to develop and oversee programs to promote good mental and spiritual health within the diocese, to consist of 10 persons appointed by the bishop, and to be representative of the breadth of the diocese and include a roughly equal number of lay and ordained persons. This resolution was submitted by the Reverend Alan Leonard, the Reverend Gregory Wilson, the Reverend Canon Joanne Izzo, Ms. Martha Francis, and Ms. Kimmy Carlos. Caroline, did you want to say a word or two about this?
Yes, thank you, Susanna. I am here to offer insights into this, this group. And Greg has given me some points to talk about if you have any questions, but the work has already begun and evolved out of a task force created by Bishop Stokes in response to spiritual and mental health needs related to COVID-19. That was the Episcopal Mental and Spiritual Health Ministry. And they had the warm line for clergy. They have done small groups focusing on anxiety and first responders. They've had more than one, but mindfulness workshops, and they've had a recent conference check-in last fall about needs. And this is a response to a great need. Greg has asked me to ask you what mental health needs you come across in the church. And we know from the conference last fall with the clergy in the room that this is evidence that this is an area in which the church needs to grow. So this is a response to that. I personally feel it's extremely necessary work. One of our goals is to change the culture around mental health and provide badly needed resources for clergy and laity. We intend to bring all this work under one umbrella and recognize it as one important priority of the diocese. So those are my comments. And I can say, as sort of a fringe member of this group, that I have enjoyed my work with this team, and I find that it is absolutely necessary.
Thank you, Caroline. Is there any discussion or questions that you have for me or for Caroline regarding this resolution? Hearing and seeing none, we will move on to resolution 2023-2, remembering the victims and survivors of the coronavirus pandemic. I'll read the resolutions as written. That the 239th Convention of the Diocese of New Jersey commend the reading of the names of those parish members lost to COVID-19 during the month of November 2023, and be it further resolved that we continually pray for those who have perished and for those who survived, and that God's grace will heal and comfort all those affected and restore them to health. And be it further resolved that the Secretary of the Convention forward a copy of this resolution to the Executive Council of the Episcopal Church. This was submitted by Mr. Thomas Meehan and Mrs. Joanne Meehan, the Reverend Lisa Hoffman, the Reverend Petrina Pyatt, the Reverend Joan Pettit Mason, and the Venerable Theodore Foley, all of Christ Church in Toms River. This is a resolution that was proposed last year, and I believe in 2021 as well, and was accepted and voted through both times that it was submitted before. And I don't think we have anyone here to defend this resolution, but I'll speak to it if anyone has any questions or comments. Hearing none, we'll move on to the third. Okay, we'll move on to the third and final resolution, which is 2023-3, remembering the September 11th, 2001 World Trade Center victims. Be it resolved that the 239th Convention of the Diocese of New Jersey reaffirm resolution 2004-1 of the 220th Convention of the Diocese, and be it further resolved that Episcopalians in the diocese continually pray for all those lost on September 11th, 2001, all others lost at the hand of terrorism, those who have made the ultimate sacrifice in the days since the attacks, those who still suffer in body and mind as a result of terrorist attacks, and all those we call peacemakers. And be it further resolved that churches of the diocese on September 11th, 2023, join in observing the 6 moments of silence that mark the loss of life in New York City, Pennsylvania, and the District of Columbia. Further resolved that the Secretary of the Convention forward a copy of this resolution to the Executive Council of the Episcopal Church. And this was submitted by Thomas Meehan, Joanne Meehan, Lisa Hoffman, Reverend Lisa Hoffman, the Reverend Petrina Pyatt, the Reverend Joan Pettit Mason, and the Venerable Theodore Foley, all of Christ Church in Toms River. And as you can see, this is a long-standing resolution that is proposed and voted in every year. But if anyone has any questions or comments about it, I stand to address those.
Any questions or comments for Susanna? Don't see any.
All right, hearing none, that concludes the preliminary report of the Committee on Resolutions. Again, if you would like to sit in on that meeting and ask any questions of the committee as a whole, that Zoom meeting for the formal hearing, the final hearing of our committee, will be this Saturday at 10 o'clock a.m. via Zoom. And if you have anything between now and then, please feel free to reach out and contact me.
Great, thank you so much, both Susanna and Caroline, for being part of that presentation tonight. Father Kirk, can you hear us? We cannot hear you. We can see you now, but we cannot hear you. Still can't hear you. You might want to check your audio settings down by the little microphone down. One of the other things that actually might be a quicker fix is if you want to go ahead and try and just leave the meeting and come back. And then we'll see if we can see if that makes a difference. Sometimes it does. I think perhaps what we'll do while Father Kirk is trying to work through that on his end, why don't we go ahead and get started with the budget presentation, Jonathan, if you're ready. And then, you know, at whatever point in time, you know, we'll either go through your presentation entirely and then just have Father Kirk do his at the end, or at whatever time he's ready. If it's a good breaking point, maybe we'll, you know, break. But you want to go ahead and get started, Jonathan?
Yes, I can go ahead and do that. I'm trying to share my screen.
We can see it.
Okay. So, good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining for this fourth pre-convention hearing. I'd like to give a quick overview this evening of our budget process we went through this year and then the final budget we arrived at. First, I'd like to thank the Finance and Budget Committee, and I see a couple of members here tonight. But we met through December 22nd, 2022, and then into January 2023. I believe we had six meetings this year that included at least one on the evening and weekends. So and very tireless meetings of several hours each session we met. So we started reviewing the budgets after we presented the budget requests from various groups, ministries, task force, commissions. Reviewed those requests, and they're all very reasonable and sound and robust and really advocated very necessary ministries throughout the Diocese of New Jersey. Unfortunately, given the revenue constraints we had this year in 2023 and some of the other challenges to with the transition of the bishop and certain staff, we just couldn't fund all the requests that were received at the levels that they were presented. Matter of fact, at the end of the first run through of the budget requests and putting together our numbers, we came out with a deficit of over $1.7 million. And we realized that was completely out of the realm of consideration, that we had to do something to bring that in. After additional meetings and intense deliberations, the Finance Budget Committee reduced this to $1.5 million. And that still wasn't a very reasonable amount to bring to consideration to Diocesan Council and the Diocese Trustees. So after the budget committee went through a couple rounds of trying to part a budget down, started discussions with Bishop Stokes with some further discussions. And at that point, a decision was made to hold the line at budget items for 2023 to what they were at the preliminary budget in 2023, which were presented to the Diocesan Convention last year in 2022, last March. Try to hold a line on all of those, except in those areas where there were necessary needs to increase or change the amount that was presented back then. And I'll go through some of those examples going on, but things like the fact that we have to cover not only the transition committee expenses, but the transition and the overlap between the bishop-elect and Bishop Stokes. Also some transition for some staff who are retiring. So after going through that process and also eliminating a proposed 5% or 4.5% cost of living increase for staff, we came up with a deficit that was $1.3 million, which is still very high. At that point, emergency meeting, we took the budget to an emergency reading of the Diocese of Trustees, who would actually be funding that deficit through trustee funds. So after meeting with the trustees, they agreed to approve the $1.3 million request for 2023 to fund the deficit, but they noted that we were about $580,000 over what was in the preliminary 2023 budget. So that approval had a contingency or provision that once they approved that for $1.3 million for 2023, that the next $580,000 from proceeds of future sale of church properties be used to reimburse the trust funds for that rather large difference between the original 2023 budget projection and what we actually came up with. Normally, the sale of church properties would go to the Mission Renewal Fund, but basically what the trustees agreed or requested was that the first $580,000 from the sale of any future properties simply reimburse the trust funds for the extraordinary amount that they're providing in the 2023 to cover our budget deficit. So after all those revisions, the budget was approved by Diocesan Council, and this is the budget I'll be presenting tonight that will be presented to convention in March. Going over to my spreadsheet here, I'll go through some of the highlights of the changes between our 2023 preliminary budget and where we wound up in 2023 for the revised budget that we're presenting now. First off is on the income side. We originally projected $3 million in March admission pledges from our various congregations across the diocese. Given the fact that at the end of 2022, we're projecting an actual income of $2,818,000, and based on the original pledges that came in for 2023, we simply projected that we're more likely to get income in 2023 from March admission pledges of $2.815 million versus the $3 million we originally projected, roughly a deficit, a difference of $184,000 in there. So right off the top, we're talking $180,000 less income than we originally projected. Line two to trust income, projecting a smaller amount there, mainly because the sale of the proceeds to actually fund the deficit, the income we get from the trust funds would also be reduced. That income is dividends or interest payments on our trust funds. So given the fact that the market's declined some and we've had to sell some of the shares in the trust fund, we're projecting that we're about $30,000 less in 2023 than we originally projected. No other significant changes in 2023 in terms of the top line of the income. You'll see the $1.2 million draw from the trustee funds for general ministry support and $110,000. That makes up that $1.3 million deficit I spoke about earlier. And those are funds that we would have to draw from the trust funds in 2023. Going down to the expense side of our budget, I'll highlight some of the major differences there. One thing at the top line is line 10, is support for mission congregations. Originally projected at $475,000 in the preliminary 2023 budget, but after deliberations and meetings with the Committee on Missions and discussions with Diocesan Council and looking at the real needs of the mission congregations, it was decided to increase that support for 2023 up to $570,000, which is $95,500 more than was originally projected. So that's a major additional expense that wasn't projected in the preliminary 2023 budget in that amount. Even at $570,000, doesn't cover all of the needs of missions, but some of that is being covered through the Mission Renewal Fund and some of that through the Diocesan Operating Fund. We're seeing a slight decrease in our actual pledge to the National Church, about $7,500 difference down from $588, which we thought at the beginning of when we did the preliminary budget, to $581, which is the actual amount that we're owed this year for the diocesan, for the Episcopal Church. So a little savings in that area. Going down to our other social and ethnic ministries, in most cases, we've kept the line in 2023 to where they were in the preliminary 2023 budget. Now, I will say that in some areas, some of these ethnic ministries or commissions and task force requested more for 2023 than what we are actually budgeting, but we felt with the revenue restraints that we would at least try to meet, in most cases, the same budget line they had in 2023. One difference I'll point out down here on line 90 is youth activities. The original budget request amount was $55,000. That was reduced to $35,000, mainly because that ministry is still picking up and recovering from the pandemic one, and they're trying to do more in-person activities. We did allocate money for an Episcopal youth event to be held this summer, budget for transportation and the cost for taking a delegation of youth to that conference. But we basically reduced some of the planned grant monies they had at the convocations. There'll still be funds available, but not at the $55,000 level, at the $35,000 level. And we're hoping with renewed interest in youth activities that we'll be able to have programs to expend those funds this year. Going down another area, in congregational development, the original budget was $45,000. They actually requested quite a bit more in 2023, but after reviewing the budgets, we've decided to leave that budget line item down to $30,000, which was a little more than about what was spent in 2022 in that amount. And also some of the costs in that area, we're hoping we could cover that, some of the administrative costs that are associated with congregational development through spreading the work along through other diocesan administrative staff, and also things like website design is hopefully covering that through working with the communication of staff for the diocese, so they could get a lot of what they're projected in the ministries done without a lot of additional extra expenses. So basically there, we've seen a reduction from what their 2022 preliminary budget was of about $15,000. Christian formation, there's $1,000 less. They actually, the ministry came in with that request to reduce their original request to $5,000, which was originally projected down to $4,000. That was on their own volition based on what they foresee their activities would be in 2023. Going down, another highlighted area is the Committee on the Priesthood. Originally, that was budgeted at $41,750. We now have it at $31,750. Again, the Committee on the Priesthood actually came in with a request to reduce their budget line item somewhat, and partly because some of those expenses are going to be split between the Committee on the Priesthood, the School of Ministry, and the Committee on the Deaconate. We're just realigning some of the funds along in those areas. So that's why there's a $10,000 less than was originally projected for 2023. Another area where there's actually a new budget line item, line 205. In the past, we'd call it clergy development, but this is for transition ministry. with Canon Izzo coming on board. She'd requested to pilot a program to help our many congregations that are in transition to provide additional coaching and more long-term coaching, supporting those congregations in transition. Also to pilot a program to do what's called a fast transition, so that given enough notice, if a priest is retiring or giving notice to leave, they can start the transition process much earlier. And that way, the time between the current incumbent clergy leaving the congregation and the new one coming aboard to sort of reduce that. So to make that happen, there's going to be need to have more additional coaching and support, direct support to those congregations. So we decided to budget $8,000 in 2023 to kick that program off. And we'll see going forward under the new bishop-elect what type of program we'll have with transition ministries going forward. But we decided to fund that at some level in 2023. One other area, line 209, the School of Ministry, we've left that at the same budget request that was in the preliminary 2023 budget, but I will say the request was to expand that program, and we just could not do that in 2023 given our constraints. But so that even though we're leaving that level, the need is out there for additional resources to support the School of Ministry. We recognize that and hope that we'll find more efficient ways of delivering that program, again, sharing some of the administrative costs or administrative duties across the diocesan staff, hopefully can reduce some of their costs that they were projecting for 2023. Other small changes are the Committee on the Diaconate. I mentioned earlier is that some of the costs that they have is sort of being split with the Committee on Priesthood. And so their budget increased slightly where we saw the Committee on the Priesthood decrease. It's not a one-for-one cut over there, but you see the priesthood was reduced by 10,000 and the deaconate increased by 3,325. But we did just realign some of the expenses between funds supporting the deaconate versus funds supporting new priests. And the Deacons Council came in on their own and requested a reduction of the original 6,075 budget line item down to 2,725. That $3,350 reduction was a request of the Deacons Council. The other small reduction in this area was the Ministry Institute. Again, we're trying, this is one of those activities of ministries that's still recovering from our COVID time where we were doing mostly remote. Originally it was projected about $1,550 budget. We've decided to leave that at $750, about half of what was originally projected, so that they could start up some in-person activities during 2023. Going down to the other area that where there's a change is General Convention and ECW Triennium. General Convention was held this year, held in 2022 in Baltimore. The next General Convention will be in Louisville, Kentucky in 2024. We realized by looking through our finance numbers and our budgeting is that we needed to incur funds to support the 2024 General Convention. That's for the travel and housing of a full delegation of delegates in person in Louisville, Kentucky, that we need to occur at a rate of $25,000 a year for the next 2 years. So that's why that's an increase of about $10,000 a year. Is just to catch up on expenses that we would need for the 2024 General Convention. 2022 expenses were much less, one, because initially the travel was much shorter, and also it turned out that it was very much a hybrid convention, a very shortened in-person time. And this year we expect it to be a full in-person General Convention, next year that is. And the other area before we get into diocesan staff is on the physical, mental, and spiritual health ministry. You heard that it was a task force going now, is that it's now being proposed to go to a full commission, a slight decrease of about $100. Again, this was a request from the commission, but that line item is pretty much fully funded as what was projected in 2023. 2023, which we are now in the revised 2023, is very close to what was asked for. So the changes, the other main area where there are changes between our preliminary 2023 budget and the final revised 2023 budget, one of the key areas is transition of bishops. Bishop-elect Sally French will be starting in April, and Bishop Stokes will be formally retiring on June 24th. So the overlap, we budgeted in an overlap between the new bishop-elect and the current bishop. And when you take into account all the costs associated with that roughly three-month overlap, it's an additional $70,000 in our revised 2023 budget than what we originally projected this time last year. Other areas of staff, we did bring on a chief financial officer in August of this year. We originally had a budget projection of $100,000 for that position. Based on market conditions, that the actual amount is $120,000. So that's just roughly $20,000 difference with the additional costs for Social Security support with that position. So basically, we've got about $21,000 additional for that staff position. Going down to other staff positions, at convention last year, there was a resolution that we fund the Canon Missioner for Black Ministries at a full-time position versus at a basically a few hours a month rate, which we had done in the past. So taking that to a full-time position and taking the normal rates for compensation guidelines for that position and all the other associated costs for completing a full-time position, the additional amount is $96,475 for that staff position. Again, that was part of a resolution presented at the 2022 Diocesan Convention, and we fulfilled that with this budget line item. Other areas of increase in diocesan staff, as I mentioned, transition of some administrative staff. Three administrative staff members will be retiring in June after Bishop Stokes leaves. And to account for the great amount of knowledge accumulated over years with those staff members, we budgeted a transition period between new replacement staff and them leaving of about 30 days or so in there. So we put that in a budget so that there is some transition amount in there so that we see an increase in administrative staff to cover that. We're projecting about $75,000 additional cost to support that transition of staff. All told for diocesan staff, you can see that from what our preliminary 2023 budget to where our final budget's coming in, that we're seeing an increase of $263,860 and additional cost projected for 2023. So that's a great, a large amount of over half of that amount of that $580,000 is primarily in staff costs, additional staff costs. The other thing where there's a little difference between the preliminary 2023 budget and the final 2023 budget is funds available for the search committee and the transition committee. Our search committee actually finished their work at the end of 2022, and we're projecting a final cost of that $59,930, about $4,900 more than what was originally budgeted over in a one-year period for search committee. Given that, though, we don't project any search committee expenses in 2023. However, the transition committee will have quite a bit of expenses in 2023. First of all, that there's a change in roles where in the past the search committee was responsible for bringing the final candidates in and doing our walkabouts and basically those meet and greet sessions with the bishop candidates, and also covering the cost of the special convention for election of a new bishop. The transition committee covered all of that cost. So in 2023, we see the transition committee needing a budget of $110,000 to cover not only the cost of the special convention, but also the installation and then the travel and moving costs for bringing the bishop-elect into the diocese. That's also covered in the transition committee costs. So that's why their budget for 2023 is $110,000. You can see that they had very small expenditures in 2022, only $7,044. Coming down to the end, basically, we're projecting additional expenditures over the 2023 revised budget of $332,950. And if I go back up to the top, we're also projecting reduced revenue from that amount of basically $184,000, and another $30,000 is a reduced revenue that we're projecting for 2023. Therefore, where the deficit that went from a projection of in the preliminary budget that we're roughly about $750,000 all the way up to $1.3 million in 2023. So that's the end of my overview presentation. Are there any questions on any specific line items? And as Phyllis says, this information is posted on the convention website under financial reports.
Thanks, Jonathan. Any questions for Jonathan? Comments? All righty. Not seeing any. I just wanted also to, unless you want to do it, Jonathan, kind of go through the process on the 2024.
Yes. Oh, yeah. Yes. Thank you. Yeah. So 2024, we have a preliminary budget, which is proposed here. In most cases, keeping things level with the expenditures that we had in 2023. One change, though, in the revenue side, we're projecting higher marks submission giving, a projection up to $3.1 million. We're just hoping that as our congregations come out of the COVID-19 pandemic conditions, that they'll see increased income and we'll have the wherewithal to provide increased marks submission pledges in 2024. So we're actually looking at a significant projection of income coming in from marks submission giving there for nearly $300,000 additional income there, which we think will reduce the deficit, and we'll not have the transition cost in 2024 of overlapping between the bishop-elect and the bishop, and also the transition between outgoing staff and incoming staff. So that'll save some of the personnel costs. We won't see increases in those areas coming up in 2024. So roughly, we're projecting in 2024 right now going in with a projected deficit of $819,000. Which is closer to what our original projection was in 2023, just a little bit more than that in that area. On the suggestion of Bishop Stokes, though, he's asked that the convention not approve a 2024 preliminary budget, that we wait to approve that after the new bishop-elect has come into the diocese and start working, and after basically a series of conversations among the diocese, which I'm told is quite similar to what happened in 2017, to really look at our mission priorities within the Diocese of New Jersey. And then we would hope that we would have a special convention in the fall of 2023 to discuss, after we've determined where the priorities and sort of how we can do our ministries in a more efficient manner, that we would then come up with a 2024 preliminary budget that we can present to convention. This would be a special convention in the fall of 2024 to handle the 2024 preliminary budget. Is there anything else on that, Elizabeth, that I mentioned? Miss?
Yeah, I mean,
Phyllis, yeah.
Definitely there. You know, that what you can expect when you're actually at the convention in a couple of weeks. Wow, that's a scary thought right there, a few weeks. For the March 4th convention is that when the time comes to, you know, we'll, you know, ask for the vote to approve the 2023 budget. But then when it comes time to consider 2024, there will be a motion made to table any further consideration of the 2024 budget to a special convention planned to be held in probably in November, somewhere around that time frame of this year, because we will obviously have to approve a preliminary 2024 budget before 2024 actually happens. So we have, you know, money to be able to operate on at least for the first 2 months of the year before our regular diocesan convention. But what that will afford us, and many of you, you know, probably the majority of you who are here with us tonight, remember from our 2017-2018 deliberations was the same thing. It was the same process because we really needed to take some time to, you know, again, review our diocesan priorities as a diocesan community, to engage in conversations across the diocese, the charrettes process that we used, where we really sort of had a you know, a system, you know, of being able to talk together with groups from all over the diocese about how they see, you know, diocesan priorities, which then enabled the Finance and Budget Committee to rework the 2020, in this case, the 2024 budget, in that case, the 2018 budget, based on the priorities and the information that came back out of those meetings. So we'll be engaging in that same kind of process this year as we did back in 2018 to address the issues of our budgeting concern. And the only other thing I just wanted to clarify a little bit, just going back to, excuse me, what Jonathan was saying about for the, in the 2023 budget, the about $580,000 difference between what we initially anticipated needing as draws on our trust funds and what we ended up needing. So, you know, basically the $1.3 million that is currently in the 2023 budget is about $720,000, or is about $580,000 more than what was anticipated when we first did the 2023 preliminary budget. That $580,000 being made up by, you know, the trustees making that request, that be replaced, replenished in the trust funds from the sale, future sale of church properties. Just want to clarify that that is only church, the sale of church properties, which would have come into the Mission Renewal Fund in the first place. So when, you know, when church properties sell that are, you know, still where there's still an ongoing congregation, whether it's a merged congregation or, you know, whatever the case may be, if there's a church property sold that actually belongs to an ongoing congregation, that money will still go to that congregation. The only thing that will be coming to the trustees is money from the sale of properties that's not otherwise designated and would have gone into the Mission Renewal Fund. Will now be first used up to the first $580,000 to replenish the trust funds for the excessive draw that's being taken in 2023. So I just wanted to clarify that so everybody's really, you know, so everybody has that understanding. All of that said, are there any other questions, comments, anything we can clarify for you? All right, not seeing any so far. Father Kirk, should we try this again? Can you unmute yourself and see if we can hear you?
Perhaps. Can you hear me, everybody, now, I hope?
Oh, yes, we can. Thank you.
All right, good. I had to make some other arrangements here with my smartphone, and okay. Hopefully it is going to function nicely.
Wonderful. Do you want me to go ahead?
Without,
mm-hmm.
too many echoes.
Yeah, it's really not too bad. Do you want me to go ahead and share my screen with the report on it?
Sure, that would be fine. Please, Phyllis.
Okay. All right, so there we go right there, and feel free to take it away.
Okay, thank you, everybody, and thank you for your patience with me tonight as I work through difficulties here with my internet connections. The first part, our report is divided into 8 parts, and the first part deals with changes to DOS and canons resulting from the Episcopal Church General Convention. And this year, I'm happy to report there are no canon changes for our diocese that are necessitated by General Convention. Okay. Part 2 is for deputies and alternates to General Convention. This is a pretty straightforward change, simply to ensure that those who are elected to serve will still be able to serve until the Diocesan Convention following the General Convention at which they have served, and thereby report to our Diocesan Convention. All right, any questions on that? All right, if not, part 3 is one of 3 parts dealing with the Standing Committee and general changes to Canon 9 for electing a bishop. And this first section is pretty pro forma, dealing with the requirement that we have consents from diocesan standing committees and bishops exercising jurisdiction to begin an episcopal election in our diocese. All right, that's really all that is involved in that first part. The second section deals with procedure for a successor to a bishop diocesan. And that's underlined. The double underlines, of course, indicate the new language, and the lines through the existing wording is the single line. All right. And it's pretty cut and dried, very simple kind of a process. The next section relates to section 3. Which is regarding the composition of the Bishop Search and Nomination Committee. And things are quite well settled, I think, already with what we have done. Section 4 deals with the election of members to serve on the Bishop Search and Nomination Committee from each convocation. And then there are 6 at-large members who are also elected to serve through the committee itself. Any questions about that? We've been through that just a few months ago, and it seemed to work very smoothly. All right. After that, we skip all the way to section 10 of that canon. And section 10 has to do with the role of the transition committee, which is now an independent group working with representation on the Bishop Search and Nomination Committee, but they will be in charge from now on of introducing the candidates to the convention and overseeing the electing convention for a bishop. All right. Okay, we can move on then. And they will also take over introducing the candidates to the electors of the convention. This was mentioned by Jonathan Gloucester in his report. Okay, and then our 5th section of reporting has to do with the Episcopal elections procedures for an independent nomination committee. And yeah, we need to go one more. There it is. And This is a procedure that was recommended by the present search and nomination committee. We looked at it. There are a number of things to be involved here about how do we receive independent nominations for bishop. And it is suggested, given the complexity of some of those issues, that we refer that proposal back to the committee for further study and presentation, hopefully next year or at a subsequent convention. All right. Part six relates to Canon 27 regarding the Board of Missions. Before, it was customary to elect members to the Board of Missions who would be elected in the fall, right in the middle of the evaluation of budget or grant requests from missions. And rather than have new people coming into the system right near the end of its annual journey through that, it has felt better to have them come aboard in January and start with the next year's process of evaluating proposals and grant requests. All right, that's really all that that would do. Section 7, then, Canon 49, Section 1, regards clergy members. It was said to be presbyters, which would mean priests only could serve on the major chapter of the cathedral. And it was pointed out that deacons ought to be eligible for serving on that chapter as well. And therefore, it is recommended that instead of presbyters, we now use the term members of the clergy that would include both priests and deacons, and also that we specify laypersons with capital letters as well. All right? That had to be changed by the constitution of the cathedral and was accomplished by the cathedral chapter some months ago. The last section, canon, part 8, relates to Canon 74, Section 1, the ministry compensation, minimum compensation, excuse me, for clergy who are occupying housing that they rent or as well as own. The canon presently doesn't permit that kind of inclusion for people who rent their housing, and this is an extension of that so that those who do so can also be included in the housing subsidy for clergy of the diocese. That concludes our report. Are there any questions? All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
I promise to do better next time, everybody.
Thanks for hanging in there. We all know what a challenge technology can be, and you figured out a way to make it happen. So thank you very much for doing that. I was sort of dreading thinking, oh my goodness, am I going to have to try to go through that? And, you know, so I'm particularly appreciative of the fact that you hung in there to get that done. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All righty. Well, if there are no further questions or comments, then I would bid you all a good evening. I would also note that Gary Kamath, our CFO, who's been with us tonight as well, thank you so much for that, Gary, put his contact information into the chat. If there are any further questions on the budget, please do feel free to contact him. Again, all of the information that we have here is included on the website. The one thing I do, and Jonathan also put his email in the chat in case you want to contact him directly. One other commercial announcement from Ann Noddy. Please, 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 If you or your any other delegates that you know of have not registered yet, please do that right away. We're really kind of running up against the deadline for that, and need to get those registrations taken care of. Though at last count, I believe we only had like 90 people registered, which is really, really low. So please do not wait to the last minute to do that, and encourage anybody else that you know of who has not registered yet to do so. I think that is about it then for this evening. Again, thank you for taking the time to be with us, to listen and to learn. And we look forward to seeing you at convention. Blessings. Good night.